this edition of Inside Texas Tech, we continue our retrospective with Chancellor Kent Hance as he talks about supporting Phi Beta Kappa and also the value of having a chapel here on campus. We'll also show you how a former Texas Tech athlete is investing his time into art. But first, we all know the importance of wine on the South Plains. Let's take a look at a Texas Tech alum who has achieved national and international success in winemaking.
You know, you build it and they will come, they do. You got to be patient, but you've got to know your wines and you've got to make good quality wines. And sometimes it's, and I tell these young guys, it's like this kid last night, you know, he was talking about it and he goes, yeah, I know, Kim, don't fall in love with them. People go, I love this wine. Don't fall in love with them. Just drink them. So that's our huge thing.
Kim McPherson is an entrepreneur, a savvy businessman, a wine connoisseur, and is also a distinguished Texas Tech alum. His wines have won over 450 medals in state, national, and international wine competitions. He plays an innovative and dynamic role in the development of the Texas wine industry. The McPhersons have been pioneering family in grape growing and winemaking in Texas for over 40 years.
My little brother's a winemaker, and I was coming back to Trefethen in Napa. My daughter graduated from University of Texas, and she worked at Trefethen, and they didn't really know who she was, and then she started some McPherson and blah, 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 and they go, oh my gosh, your dad worked here. So she's involved in the wine business, and she's going for her sommelier, master sommelier. She thinks she's going to tell me. No. We'll see.
In 1976, Dr. Clinton A. McPherson, also known as Doc, a chemistry professor at Tech, and Bob Reed founded Llano Estacado Winery in Lubbock, one of the first post-prohibition Texas wineries. However, Kim attributes his family's success to his mother.
She was behind Doc in a lot of things, you know, getting things done and, you know, making sure that everything was on an even keel. And because sometimes my dad was sort of out there on an artist type thing, you know what I mean? He was making wines and thinking of this when, hey, we got to get, you know, she kept the thing going. So my dad was the one that, you know, did all the stuff in the garage, but, you know, he got money raised and he built the winery, and it's the second largest winery in the state.
West Texas plays a vital role in the Texas wine industry.
This is where all the best grapes are grown, right up here, really, 40 miles south of here. I mean, right there on the edge of Lubbock County, 1585 and south, this is where all the best, this is where all the wineries come for their fruit.
His advice to young entrepreneurs, be persistent.
I'm just telling the young people, don't give up. You got to take it and you got to grab the deal and the dream, and you got to run with it. You can't sit here and think about how it might have been. I mean, I could sit here and go, God, what if I'd have stayed in California? And it's like, no, well, you know, it just led me here.
Kim and Doc were inducted into the Who's Who in Food and Wine in the Texas Hall of Fame in 1999. And Kim created the McPherson Cellars label in 2000 to honor his father. Reporting for Texas Tech Public Broadcasting, I'm Lauren Bogle.
It's a priority at Texas Tech to have its students leave with not only a degree, but also minimal debt. Texas Tech's Red to Black program prepares students for financial security through personal financial planning. Let's take a look at more.
Students who are exiting college, they're finishing up the program, they're finishing up the degree, I think it's really important that they have a basic understanding of what their money is doing, not only for the economy with the community that they're in, but also for themselves and their future. Red to Black really kind of allows them to focus on some of those things personally, allows them to focus on their monthly budgeting and retirement and things like that, and also the taxes that they would have to pay into our government system. I think it's really important to be aware of some of those things, and even if they don't have a degree in finances or a degree in personal financial planning, it's important to at least have a basic understanding or just be familiar with what that money is doing for them.
We see them one-on-one in a financial coaching session where they meet with one of our volunteers who's been trained. They're PFP students, personal financial planning students, and they've been trained on many topics for financial issues. So budgeting, establishing credit, how to clean up a credit report, maximizing student loans, those types of things.
I'm very interested in volunteering for the Red to Black department because of the interaction I get with students, the opportunities to discuss some of the things that I'm learning in my classes and applying them directly to a one-on-one sit down with another student where I can really understand what I've learned and apply it to maybe real-world experience. I grew up in Lubbock and my family was really middle class kind of growing up, and there was a lot of resources that we were limited in. And so when a student comes in sharing some of those similar experiences, I'm able to relate to them and kind of help them through some of the things that I've experienced and maybe even explore some things that they might not have considered.
I think most financial issues come down to creating a budget. And whether it's trying to figure out how to make those payments right out of college and gonna have a lot of student loan debt, or getting money for the first time in a big paycheck, how to manage that really all comes down to making a budget. And so if we can teach people how to track their expenses and know that their expenses have to be less than their income, then that really is going to serve them for the rest of their lives. I think being able to meet students where they are and help them really make a difference in their lives, not just while they're at Texas Tech, but be able to give them some skills that will take them further and help them in the rest of their lives is really rewarding.
Personal financial planning in general is very underrated in today's society, because no matter what career you have, no matter what department you work in, you deal with finances. It's a major aspect of our everyday lives, and it's very important that we have a deeper understanding than we might have right now. So whoever you are and wherever you are, you cannot avoid personal finances, because whether you're budgeting to go to the grocery store, whether you're budgeting for your retirement at the end of your career, all these things take personal financial planning into consideration.
This spring, there have been a series of receptions all across the state honoring the Chancellor for his achievements at the Texas Tech system, including one here in Lubbock at the United Spirit Arena, which included Governor Rick Perry.
State, city, and Texas Tech University officials were on hand to honor the career and many achievements of Chancellor Kent Hance.
Well, thank you for joining us. This is a special day to honor a special man, Chancellor Kent Hance, for his dedicated service and leadership to the Texas Tech University system and to higher education in the great state of Texas.
One of Kent's crowning achievements, which is also remarkable, and I think Kent would be the first one to tell you that he had a lot of help in this, is the Vision and Tradition campaign, the fundraising campaign for Texas Tech that finished approximately a year early. And in that process, Kent and the entire institutional advancement team and the leadership of Texas Tech, many of whom are seated here today, raised over $1 billion.
One of the very special guests was longtime Hance friend, Governor Rick Perry.
I tell people that I'm the Kent Hance of economic development in Texas, because Kent Hance recruits more kids to come to school here. I mean, this guy, I mean, he is the greatest salesman. This guy could sell anything, but he knows how to sell Texas Tech University because he believes in it so much.
Because of Hance's 7-plus years serving the Texas Tech system and in turn the Lubbock community, the city gave him a special honor.
It's from the city of Lubbock. It's special recognition. And it says, now therefore, we the mayor and the city council of the great city of Lubbock do hereby recognize Kent Hance Day, and we extend our heartfelt thanks for a job well done and our best wishes for all his future endeavors. It's dated this second day of April 2014.
Though he may be retiring as chancellor, Hance will always be part of this university.
Texas Tech was really blessed. It was blessed to have a man of his caliber who would lead this university.
Our best days are in front of us. In this university, always remember this, no one person, this university is not dependent on anyone. It is an institution within itself, and it's moving forward by leaps and bounds. Thank you very much, and God bless Texas Tech.
When we come back, we continue to feature the Chancellor's impending retirement. He looks back at some of his favorite memories.
This is Texas Tech University.
We inspire.
We discover.
We succeed.
We ride.
We share our traditions.
And our innovations.
We are champions.
We work hard.
And play louder.
We are many things.
But wherever we go.
And whatever we do.
Every day.
Every day.
Todos los días.
Every day.
Every day, we are Red Raiders.
In addition to having been the chancellor for the last 8 years of the Texas Tech University system, Kent Hance is also one of the system's largest individual donors. He talks about the importance of giving, how it has affected him, and some of his other favorite memories as the chancellor.
You talk about the faith, and you put your money where your mouth is, and you built a chapel here, and you were the primary donor for that. How proud are you of that as you drive by it or go in there?
Well, I love the chapel. We spent more money. We went over budget. Guess who had to make up the budget? The shortfall. But we went over budget because of the sound system, and it is quiet in that chapel. And each day from 11 till 2, it's open, and people can go in and meditate. And it's we've had a lot of weddings there. There's also a church service Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday. And the crew, the Campus Crusade for Christ, they have a meeting there. I believe theirs is on Tuesday or Thursday night. And Fellowship of Christian Athletes have met there before. And then we've had funerals. We've had memorial services. Dr. Guy Bailey, who loved Texas Tech, his wife Jan passed away. And she was a great Red Raider. And we had her memorial service to a packed crowd.
I know you'll still be around. What's be the hardest thing when you leave this office for the last time? What's going to be the hardest thing to give up?
I don't know that, I have to think about that, but I'm not leaving Tech. I'll still be around. I won't have to do the day-to-day duties. I can still go to graduation if I want to. I can still talk at orientation if I want to. I can do things like that I think that are fun. But the day-to-day operations of handling problems, I don't want to have anything to do with that. I don't want anyone to ask me what to do. That's going to be somebody else's problem. That'll be the new chancellor's problem and the president's problem, and I'll back them whatever they decide because I know they'll make good decisions.
And you told me once, you said, if I was going to stay until everything I wanted to accomplish was accomplished, I'd never leave.
Someone asked me, said, are you going to stay until you get all your goals met? Well, my major goals, raising $1 billion and research, things like that. But if you solve all the problems and you do all your goals, but if you solve all the problems, you'll never leave. Because there's always, we're talking about almost 45,000 students in the system and about 18,000 employees, full-time and part. You're always going to have problems. My wife always liked it if I got a call late at night and she could only hear my conversation and I would say, they did what? She knew that's going to be an interesting story. But and college students will surprise you sometime. They'll do some things they probably shouldn't do, but they'll surprise you in doing some great things too.
If you had a chance to reflect on, hey, I've had a pretty good career, not only what you've accomplished, congressman and law practice and all those things, but just as a Red Raider and what you've done here at Texas Tech, you had a chance to hit, well, I've really had an impact when it's all said and done for Texas Tech.
I think I have had an impact, and that I see some of the kids we teach and some of the kids we got here that we recruited. And they're doing great. They're going to touch the world. They're going to have an impact in this world, the kids that are coming out of Texas Tech. But being chancellor is probably, it's a highlight of my life, along with 1981 carrying President Reagan's tax cut, the Conable Hance Act, which still today is the largest tax cut in the history of the country. Those two things probably have been the biggest things in my professional career.
It's funny you mentioned this because I was talking to Alice White about Phi Beta Kappa, and she said, one thing I'll tell you about Kent Hance, he gets the importance of Phi Beta Kappa.
When I got here, we didn't have a Phi Beta Kappa chapter. We got here shortly after. I can't take credit for that. The credit started back in the 90s. Credit started under Jim Sal as chairman of the board, pushing hard for it. It started under John Monford, who was chancellor at the time. and he took up the cause and he worked hard for it. And then went through David Smith, the chancellor, and went through the other presidents. But we got a Phi Beta Kappa chapter, and that's the most prestigious honorary organization in the nation. And it was such that, there are only three schools that are public schools in Texas that have a Phi Beta Kappa chapter. University of Texas had one a long time. A&M has had one about 10 years, and then Texas Tech. And the last 3 years, we have been voted one of the top 10% Phi Beta Kappa chapters in the nation. So it means so much that we have a Phi Beta Kappa chapter. As we get to a point that someday hope we will get AAU status, that Phi Beta Kappa chapter means a lot.
Everyone knows that, you know, they come to the football games, come to the basketball games, but the economic impact Texas Tech, the system overall, has had on this area and the state.
In 2012, they did a study. The economic impact on the state was $9.9 billion, almost $10 billion from this school. You know, from the people that we turned out, the incomes they were producing, the jobs they were producing. It's huge. This is a driving economic engine in the state, but especially in West Texas.
Coming up, we show you the newest addition to the art collection on the Texas Tech campus, and Baron Batch will talk to us about his career after football. I'm waking up.
My father was drafted into Vietnam at the height of the conflict. He became a single parent of two young children. We moved a lot. We slept in rest areas. We slept in our car. I didn't realize that we were actually homeless. It makes your world really small. If we happened to stay in a motel that happened to have a TV, it was really special. We loved Nova, especially when it would be about space. We would talk for hours about the universe. Watching Nova, I felt big, like my mind was big, my ideas were big. The trajectory of my life changed. I could see a world outside of our poverty, and I felt like things were gonna get better. PBS opened up a world I didn't know existed.
As we've shown you over the last several episodes, Texas Tech has made a substantial investment into its public arts program. Let's take a look at the newest addition to the art collection at the Jerry S. Rawls College of Business.
As a finishing touch to its new home, the latest addition to the Texas Tech University System Public Art Collection was recently placed outside of the Rawls College of Business. The piece, titled "We Are in the Business of Changing the World," was designed by BC Sculpture. The artists, Tara Conley of Houston and Joe Barrington of Throckmorton, Texas, created a multi-element installation located in the college's south courtyard that represents the various elements of business, from the local to the global level. Students entering into the building can now pass under two bent pipe arches with a bull and a bear on each side of their path to class. The piece, both directly and abstractly, represents the volatile nature of today's market, as well as the energy and breadth that goes into business. The two arches are made of 240 separate pieces, and the installation includes six bronze plate icons arranged around a circle on the ground that display various commodities native to the Lubbock region and community. The circle is also surrounded by several phrases engraved in limestone. Included is a familiar phrase to all Red Raiders: "Dream no little dreams," inspired by Chancellor Kent Hance. This is the largest single public art expenditure for the TTU System Public Art Collection to date. The public art program was initiated by the Board of Regents in 1998 as an investment in the campus environments at each of its institutions. Since then, 91 items have been added to the collection.
Baron Batch made his name here in West Texas on the football field, being a proficient running back for the Red Raiders. Now he's done with football. He's making his name off the field as an artist. Let's take a look at more.
Deep down, I always knew what I was going to do in life was going to be bigger than football. I think it would be foolish to not think that. I think players that just want to be known as an athlete, I think that's foolish, because I don't believe that's what humans are made to do, just to be one thing. And I always knew that I wanted to do a lot more than football. So when it got to the point where I realized that my time was my most important asset, it became very easy to say no to things that didn't align with where I saw myself going and what I needed to use my time for to get there. If you don't do what you want to do and what you love to do, you might as well just jump in your casket. And it sounds very harsh, but that's the truth. I think the craziest thing that people have fallen into this belief system is this. You get a job because it pays the bills, or you make money from it. You don't care if you like it or not. You do this job to save up enough money to store it away, to retire, and have enough money to live on and then die. That's crazy to me. It's one I did very, very early on. It's a sunset with a lot of stars and a little house on a hill. And when I was growing up, I grew up in a little trailer house out in the middle of nowhere. So when I painted this, it was my house. I saw it as the little trailer house out in the middle of nowhere. And I remember I'd always go look at the stars at night. We lived out so far out in the country that, you know, light didn't impede the stars. Like, you could see every star in the sky, it felt like. And I'd always look at the stars, and I remember I'd think that it was such a cool idea that so many people that have done great things looked at the same exact stars that I looked at. And it was almost like, for me, like looking at the stars, it was like the ultimate like equalizer. Like if whoever did any great thing in the world looked at the same sky I did and went on to be great, like, it doesn't matter what situation I'm in now, like, we're all the same, I could do the same thing. I think everybody, whatever you do, whether you're the garbage man, whether you're the construction guy, whether you're a doctor, you do it your best, you know, and that's your legacy. People that have really left a mark with me, if you just laid out their profession and asked other people how important of a profession that is, people would be like, oh, well, it's much cooler that you played in the NFL. But not really, because without that person who was the coach or who was the school cafeteria, I would have never played in the NFL. And I think about that, and it's really cool to be known and to have, you know, people buy my art and all of that. But the best thing is being able to impact people, simply with the way I live my life. And I think that, I don't know, I think more people should kind of have that goal, just like having a presence that is attractive, that people enjoy being around, and then being able to rub off on people in a positive way. I think that investing in people is like the best investment. I made the salsa initially for a thank you gift for the equipment staff when I was with the Steelers, because they mailed some stuff off for me or something like that. And I was like, yeah, I'll bring you guys some salsa. And they were like, yeah, I mean, we can't, there's no good salsa up here. So I brought it in. Some of the players got their hands on it. And before I knew it, I was like taking orders like weekly, like who needs salsa this week? And it got to the point where I was like, guys, like, I can't just keep just giving this to you for free. Like, I'm coming out of pocket to make it. It takes time, it's messy. Like, I have to be compensated. So I was selling it to the guys on the team, and it got to the point where I was like paying my rent with like salsa money. It's crazy. Now I run a salsa business, and that's one of the things I do, but I love it, and it's fun, and it's great. I'm so competitive, I want to take over every industry that I choose to. And that sounds crazy, but that's just how I am. I want to be, if I choose to do something, I don't want to be mediocre at it. In football, a lot of times, you know, the work you put in, how hard you work, lots of times it's rewarded, but a lot of times it's not. Sometimes you might have a player who's just better than you athletically. Maybe a coach likes him more. Maybe in the NFL, they're getting paid more, so a team's financially more committed. But in the business world, it's like if you go out and you hustle and you work more than other people and you work harder than other people and you put out a better product than other people, you'll be successful. 5 or 10 years from now, I mean, I don't know, I want to be a shark on Shark Tank. I want to be the best me I could possibly be through my art or just painting all the time, like improvements and stuff that I see. Like, I surprise myself, and it's a good feeling because you know you worked for it and you know you deserve it.
Thank you for tuning in. See you next Thursday right here on Channel 5 Texas Tech Public Broadcasting. And for more of our stories, check out KTTZ.org. Have a good night.